Another thing that we have to think about as we start moving in toward our more formal speeches, our informative and our persuasive, excuse me, is how we cite and credit sources. And it's going to be a little bit different from how we did it for our formal research papers, which you have had a good amount of experience with. So when we get done, can you describe the difference between crediting a source in a paper versus a speech? So we have to think about those differences. And do you understand how to use sources ethically as a speaker? Because as I've said before, numbers don't lie, but people certainly do. And numbers can really, and statistics, quotes can really be twisted and turned for a speaker's advantage that may not be exactly ethical to the original source. So, the end justifies the means. And this is a favorite quote by an ancient philosopher called Machiavelli. And really, what Machiavelli said was, if your end is good, if you have a good intention, you want to stop people from smoking, it doesn't matter how you get that result. And so he sometimes advocated and said it was okay to use unethical means to get to an ethical end. So if the end was good, how you got there, not so much Machiavelli's concern. We live in a society that's not really okay. We want both ethical ends and ethical means to get there. People don't like to be manipulated. We can't make false claims. That's actually against the law. Even though we believe our product is good and might save the world, we can't make claims that aren't true to get people to buy it or use it, even though we know it's for their best interest. We have to be ethical in how we convince people and how we present information. So, a speaker's ethics. As a speaker, you have an ethical responsibility. You shouldn't prejudge your audience, what they do or don't know, what they do or don't believe. Really, it's that don't assume anything. So don't talk down to them. Don't talk too high over their head. Don't assume that they all disagree with you and are going to be a hostile audience. Don't assume they all agree with you and you can gloss over important persuading elements for that the people who disagree with you need to hear to change their mind. Never ever distort or misrepresent information. It's really tempting to find that study that says 9 out of 10 people achieved results, you know, total cure of their cancer by taking this herbal supplement. The problem is there were only 10 people in this study and they, you know, don't represent, and they were all, you know, white men or, you know, Pacific Island women. Too small of a study, too small of a sample to generalize it out to the larger group. Always be careful about stereotyping and generalization, those broad strokes. You want to be really careful about those. You want to think about making listeners' lives better. So even if they disagree with you, they should take something away as far as even just understanding what the other side believes. In a persuasive situation, you're not going to change everyone's mind, but make it worth their time to have listened open with an open mind and thoughtfully to you. In an informative kind of setting, make sure that you're sharing interesting information. And you know, my gaming scenario: am I going to go out and you know start playing Black Ops or Fortnite or any sort of other game? Probably not. But even I can learn something from an informative speech on that, especially from somebody who's really knowledgeable and it's something they're really good at and really interested in. There's still things for me to learn and take away from that speech, even if it's just understanding my students better or my son better. So don't waste our time either. That's the converse. Don't, you know, be so simplistic or, you know, talk about something that isn't going to make, you know, give us some good takeaway when we're done. And then always, always, always credit your sources. So what do we mean by credit your sources? We, in public speaking, we want to be aware of giving date source, you know, is your research study from 1980? Probably not relevant anymore. Is it from last week? Super relevant, and we want to know that. It's not that the 1980 source isn't relevant, but you have to frame it as perhaps this is where we were in 1980, sources, studies say, and now in 2017, we've found this. This is how far we've come. So you can use some of those old sources, but you need to use them appropriately and you need to be forthright about where they are from and how old they are. Some topics, older sources don't matter because they're not changing that fast. Newer topics, you have to have things that are evolving very quickly, medical research, technology. You need to have far more current sources in order to really be representing your topic appropriately. Credibility. This goes primarily to websites. If you find magazine articles on your database or newspapers, they have an inherent credibility. They might have bias though, and we're going to talk a little bit more about that in a second. But Wikipedia is not credible, and we can argue about it all day, but we won't. It is an open source to be edited by anyone who can say they are anyone, and they can put anything on there. And yes, there is a checking board and a filter, but what if you happen to log in and look something up in the in-between of that check, and someone has put a bunch of false or misleading information on there? So you always want to be thinking about that. The other thing with credibility is that bias piece. If you are using a fairly random website, you need to go to the About Us. You need to go to the Contact Us. You need to figure out who is putting this information on, what bias or agenda do they have for putting this information out. You might go to the site and find out that it is a highly political, either Republican or Democratic, kind of site, and that is going to change the way they present information. Not that they're lying on either side of the other, but obviously they are going to color information in their party's favor and against the other party. So you need to be careful about that thing. That you want to look for things like education sites and nonprofit sites, and not that those are just blanket okay or unbiased, but it gives you an idea about what agenda they may have that then might slant their information. Again, not that you wouldn't use it, but you have to know what you're using and use it ethically. We do have to avoid plagiarism in speaking as well as in writing. You've been talked to and taught how to use proper MLA citations in your paper to give credit. We have to do a similar sort of thing in our speeches. We have to give credit to research that is not our own. So if you paraphrase somebody's research findings and you don't say that it's from Johns Hopkins medical research team, that's not okay. It makes it sound like yours. If you don't tell us that you're directly quoting someone and you make it sound like you have these eloquent, well-chosen, well-crafted words, that's not okay. That's plagiarism. If you really present anything as if you did the research or you did that writing, that's plagiarism in public speaking. So if you cite numbers, you got to have a source because you did not go do that research. Now, if you do take a poll in the lunchroom or in your advisory, it's okay to do those sorts of things. They're not super statistically accurate, but they might be a good intro or outro conclusion kind of material. Then you can say, in research I conducted, or in a quick random poll I conducted yesterday in the lunchroom, and you can give yourself credit. So just to give you a comparison, in a paper, you might see a quote like this. If you have not been immunized against measles and come near an infected person, you have a 90% chance of getting measles. And that in-text parenthetical citation with the author's last name of Hussink. So then we would go to the Works Cited and we would have Hussink, comma, his first name, the title of the article, the source that it came from, we'd have all that information. And as readers, we can see that in-text citation. But as speakers, it's not like you give that statistics and then you go, Hussink, like you're giving a parenthetical after you give the quote. That doesn't work. So we have to do more verbal citations. And so that same quotation might look something like this, and a speech might sound something like this. According to Dr. Sandra Hussink, in an article from the American Academy of Pediatrics, if you have not been immunized, you have a 90% chance of contracting measles if you come in contact with a contagious person. So now I know who said it, and I've given some credibility. This is someone from the Academy of Pediatrics, the American Academy of Pediatrics. Highly credible, very well researched, somebody I can really trust. So I've given credibility, and I've given the author's name. The only thing that's really missing here is maybe a date. Although contracting or not contracting isn't necessarily a date-specific item, so maybe we're okay not giving a date here. But if we talk about the increase in measles or the number of measles cases that are on the rise, then we should have some dates that go along with that research. So when you are working on your speeches, we are still going to use the Purdue OWL website. It is linked here for you. If the link doesn't work, you can just Google Purdue OWL MLA. It will take you right to the website. For your informative speeches and your persuasive speeches, you will have to turn in a proper MLA Works Cited. That means alphabetized, double-spaced, hanging indent, all the commas, quotes, periods, where they belong, web addresses per their new rules. So we'll talk a little bit about more about that closer, but you will have to provide that. That will be handed in along with your outline. And then you have to think about giving, instead of in-text citations like we would in a paper, you're going to give those oral credibility and citation information in kind of a smooth and seamless way. It has to sound really natural. So you really need to think about, how am I going to phrase and credit where this source is coming from? So you have to provide those citations for every speech. There's requirements for the number of sources you must cite for each of the speeches as we get moving. Basically, if you say it, cite it. If you attribute a source, if you've taken research from somewhere, then you better cite it, and it has to be cited orally. We don't have the luxury of those in-text parenthetical citations. And then, as I mentioned, your MLA Works Cited, alphabetical, double-spaced, hanging indent, and then don't guess. Nobody memorizes this. English teachers might know a few of the basic ones off the top of their head because we've been doing it a really long time, but this isn't a test of your memory or your guessing. Look it up. Do a split screen. Pull that website up and just follow along. Commas, periods, quotes, capitals, they all matter. They all count. They're all there for a reason. And just look it up every time. Just look it up. There's no excuse. So that's your Works Cited. So hopefully now you understand the difference between crediting in papers versus your speech, and some tips about being ethical and how you plan to use sources in your future speeches.